Yo, what it do? It's your boy Yellow the Poet, and today I'm here with Mr. Bansal, entrepreneur, investor, has a cruise fair for ICP India Hub, and also an author of 44 Vedic Wealth Hacks, and also an educationalist. We are here today with Mr. Bansal, and thank you so much for joining YTP Entertainment. It is a pleasure definitely having you here. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Yellow, for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be here. It's a good day. Thank you for inviting me. Very excited for our conversation.
Yes, indeed. I'm ready. So please let us know what you have going on now.
Yep. So brief about myself. I started my entrepreneurial journey around 10 years back, with a B2B merchandise company, which was called Quadby Apparel, where we used to manufacture hoods, t-shirts for various corporations, including JP Morgan, Uber Eats, L'Oreal, all of our clients. We were the second largest company in India by 2019, and it's still a lifestyle business and going good for me. In 2016, I entered into the realm of blockchain and cryptocurrencies, and it really intrigued me when I was introduced to Bitcoin. And I invested, some in 2016 and then made a good amount in 2017 and then lost it all in 2018 bear market, as usual. But again, then in these 3 years from making money to losing it all, I understood various cycles and I wanted to share it with the Indian audience. So we started a company called FinStreet, which used to create content in Hindi, which is our native language. And we used to create Web3 and blockchain content for students and entrepreneurs in India. And so we have tied up with around 200 universities across India. And we worked with more than 250 blockchain companies, including 30 from the top 100. And we were acquired by 2021. And the acquisition of FinStreet gave me good exit monetarily. And obviously the time that I needed in my life to rethink. And I started angel investing, mentored a few startups, helped them grow, helped them scale up. And so I'm still doing it. So angel investing is something that I'm very passionate about. And on 2023, ICP, Internet Computer Protocol, which is a Europe, Zurich-based company, they reached out to me and they want me to need somebody who can do India activation for us and can, catch up with Indian entrepreneurs, developers, students, investors, and everybody. So can you create an ecosystem for ICP in India? I said, why not? And then we created ICP India Hub and we are doing activation for ICP in India. And now we are scaling up that thing. So it's good. And I really enjoyed that journey.
Awesome.
Personally. And so I'm still doing it. And we're doing boot camps, incubator hackathons for the student builders across India. So that is something that I do at now.
That is awesome. So really quick, for our audience, what is blockchain?
So blockchain, consider it as a ledger, right? In old days, there was a ledger and that was a copy where you write all your expenses, money in, money out. Blockchain is a digital ledger, but the additional feature that it has, it cannot be tampered. Once recorded, something in that ledger cannot be changed by anybody. No central party, no developer, or the creator of Bitcoin even cannot change it because there are like group of miners who are distributed across the world and there are like 100,000 people, for example, the 100,000 people who are mining Bitcoin across the world. And you need at least 50,000 of those to change anything in the ledger, right? And it's a very tedious process. Hence, it's very secured with the computation it has with the investor. So it's a great monetary tool. It's a digital investment, digital currency that can be traded with, and it's secured by mathematics and run by computing. So yeah.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Because there's a lot of people who are confused about cryptocurrency, blockchain, and just really trying to understand how it actually works, that a lot of people are confused about that. So I am extremely happy to have someone like you on this show because I talk to a lot of people every day and they are like, man, it's so good that you have people on there with finance, people about cryptocurrency, people with blockchain, people with the talking about the e-wallets and things of that nature. These people are really happy because there's not a lot of There are a lot of podcasts that actually talk about it, but sometimes they don't get a good enough breakdown as to what they're really trying to get themselves into. And it's just a blessing. Like, seriously, it's a blessing for people like you and some of my other people who I've had or as guests on the show to be able to help, make the people more comfortable about doing it.
Absolutely, because it's a new stream. You have to understand that blockchain is just 15-year-old technology, and it just came out in 2008 was the time when Bitcoin white paper got published, and 2009 was when the first Bitcoin was mined. It's a new technology in general. So whenever a new technology kicks in, people get some time to understand that technology and the importance of that technology. That's why they need to learn about it. It's not a new technology. Even if you can't invest your money, if you don't want to invest the money in Bitcoin, you consider it as a risky instrument, which it is because it's a new instrument. But it's good to learn about it, and learning about it can incentivize you a lot. Because I'll tell you my story if you are okay with it, right?
Yes.
So I had a very crazy story. I used to love economics as a subject, right? And I wanted to learn more about economics and discussions around economics. So I joined a forum called bitcointalk.org,
Okay.
right? And there was a economics forum out there where people used to discuss about economics. People used to discuss about how microeconomics or macroeconomics change the future. And I used to discuss it out of curiosity. There were very good professors from all the big universities across the world discussing about economics, and I used to love the conversation. I used to discuss the conversation,
Right.
and so everything in the world is inflationary. That is, for example, every asset class is inflation. For example, the US dollar. So the government prints US dollar, and there are like more US dollars in inflation. For example, gold. Now we have X number of gold on Earth, and every year they mine more gold from the Earth's crust, right? So the circulation of gold keep on increasing, but it's an inflationary asset.
Okay.
But they said that let's experiment with a deflationary asset class. Let's make it deflationary. And they decided to bring a token. It was called BOMB token, BOMB, BOMB
Okay.
token. And every time you used to transact, so they used to deduct like one or two token, got burned every time, right? It was a cool concept. And they airdropped a BOMB token to everybody who was on that forum discussing about it. I went there just to learn about economics, and I came back with a bunch of BOMB tokens, which I eventually sold for $12,000, and I got it for free.
Oh,
So
wow.
imagine this industry is so rewarding that I got 12, which is a small amount, right? It's not a life-changing amount, but at the same time, $12,000 for free is a good thing when you are learning something for free already. So yeah,
Yes.
so these kind of things happen in the Web3 and blockchain industry. So the process is called airdrop. Till date, there are like a lot of airdrops if you use a particular protocol, and it's a good way to make money. And you don't have to spend anything. If you have genuine curiosity about learning the subject or exploring a dApp or ecosystem, once they drop their tokens or once they launch their tokens, they'll airdrop some of the tokens to everybody in the ecosystem.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Airdrop. Definitely something to look into. So if anybody is actually paying attention to this, make sure that you check out Airdrop. So let me ask you this, is it possible for there to be a surplus in the blockchain industry?
Sorry?
Is it possible for there to be a surplus in the blockchain energy, like an overabundance of cryptocurrency and things of that nature? Is that possible?
So for Bitcoin, it's not possible because the supply of Bitcoin is capped at 21 million Bitcoins. So you can't create more. But again, for the other cryptocurrencies, people are making whatever they want, and there they can be surplus. But if you stick to Bitcoin, then there's no chance of getting the surplus. They
Okay.
are capped at 21 million.
Awesome. Awesome. So how do you implement blockchain in your line of work?
So what we do is we work with a blockchain, as I've already told you. It's a Zurich-based blockchain, and it's a top 20 very legit blockchain projects called Internet Computer Protocol. So what we do is we create a pathway for them to have an adoption in India. We try to increase the adoption of there in India via all of these things via hackathons, where we invite all these college students and young professionals to build something on it. And if they're selected in the top 5 or top 10, for example, we will give them prize money, which can be as good as $5,000 or as low as $200. But again, they are learning something as well as they can compete in a competition and get some reward for it. Or we are launching an incubator where if you want to launch a blockchain startup, we will fund you an entirety and we will help you building it. And so all of these things are there. So we are trying to create adoption for the ICP and blockchain in India. So that's my line of job in the Web3 space.
Oh, that's pretty cool. I like that. I like that. So, where do you see the future of blockchain going?
In the future, I particularly see that blockchain will be ma very mainstream. And in US, there are already Bitcoin ETFs, right? And they are like a trending topic in the US finance market. And people, the institutions, the VC funds, the wealth managers want to invest a bit of their fund into the Bitcoin via ETFs. Hence, we can see a lot of institutional play and institutional money coming in into the Bitcoin market. Which can further increase the price of Bitcoin and can further create it as a big influence.
That's awesome. That is awesome. So you see, like, for like registering an innovative idea, do you see like patents and things of that nature being formed for blockchain?
So in blockchain, we believe in an open internet culture. Hence, we don't believe in patents. The all the innovations in blockchain you will see, it's already open source. Rather than keeping it, patents is the other end of the story. They don't keep it private as well. They keep it open source so that anybody can come in and anybody can build on the top of it. Because this industry is new and the innovators and the builders in this industry are so welcoming that they want you to build on their technology.
All right.
Hence, they will always motivate you that, okay, you should do it, you should build upon it, and all kind of stuff.
Awesome. Awesome. That's what's up. I love it. I love it. I love it. I love it. So, what are some of the potential problems or challenges that a person could face when they're getting involved in blockchain as it stands now?
The problems, first of all, if you are trading into it, then the gas fee can be a problem, the transaction fee, because sometimes it's on the higher end. For example, you have to pay maybe $40 or $50 just to make a transaction on the blockchain, and it can hurt some people's pocket at times. And this is the one of the issues that people face, specifically if they are onboarding onto Bitcoin or the Ethereum ecosystem. Solana or ICP is way cheaper and they are better. But again, for the newcomers, Bitcoin and Ethereum are comparatively costlier in terms of the transaction fees. The other thing is the learning curve, because again, if you're coming from a Web3 ecosystem, then there is a steep learning curve that you have to go through. But once you go through, it's very rewarding, it's very enriching, and it also gives you a good what do you call a stimulus to your brain and your thought process, because it's a new industry. Not in terms of technology, but in terms of philosophy as well. So hence you will be intrigued and you'll get to know about a lot of things.
Okay. All right. So one of the other things I'm curious about is, so when would you use the RSA cryptographic algorithm? When would you use that?
So you don't have to use it, because again, for example, Bitcoin is based on SHA-256, right? It's an algorithm. But I need not to do it. For example, do you know how US dollars are printed in the exact manner and what is the process they follow and how they decide how many US dollars they need to print every year? No, you don't, right?
Right.
Because you just need to use the currency for your transactional purposes. In a similar fashion, if you are coming in as a trader or as investor or as a builder, then you don't need to understand all of these nitty-gritties of the algorithms and everything. You just have to understand the basics and the philosophies around it. And if you want to understand the philosophies in it's a book called The Bitcoin Standard, which is a very good read if you want to understand the philosophy. And it's a non-technical book altogether, right? So it's a good book. And if you want to understand the technology, or as you have said, the algorithms behind it, then there's a book called Mastering Bitcoin. It's a great book if you want to learn about the technical part of the Bitcoin. Hence, these two books can serve the purpose.
Okay, awesome, awesome. So, is there ever a time where you store your database as a flat line?
Yeah, so they are like a node providers. We call them node providers, NODE. What they do is they store the whole blockchain on their nodes, and anybody can run a node, right? You can run a node on your PC, and you will get a copy of whole blockchain on your computer. Now, the good part is, for example, if I'm lying to you that I gave you Bitcoin like 3 years back or 4 years back, everybody has the copy of that node. Everybody has the copy of that ledger. And anybody can verify whether I gave it to you or not. We don't need courts. We don't need any legal process. It's a node, and I'll run it on my computer and I'll check it. Okay, Yellow doesn't give any Bitcoin to Bundle back then. So it's a great thing to understand.
Awesome. So, what do blockchain forks produce? What do they produce?
Blockchain forks are basically, as I told you, that every technology in the Bitcoin or the blockchain space is open source, right? For example, I created a software which can automate the YTP Entertainment podcast, right? And now you want to do it for some other podcast, right? What you'll do is you will just use my code. And if you're using my code and building and making some changes as per your convenience or as per your schedule, then it will be called like forking of my blockchain product or my blockchain app. So forking is just like using the old technology and building on the top of it.
So is that similar to like piggybacking? Like, for example, if someone had an idea and someone else wanted to come along and use that same idea but kind of tweak it, is it kind of like
Yeah.
that?
Yeah, exactly. It's the same way only. For example, if you have an idea and or you code that idea. Now, if that idea is in the code format, right, and you have coded as a developer, and I'm using your code and making some changes into it, then I'm forking your code. So it's just a terminology, and it's very much appreciated in this. So we have two kind of forks in it. So one are called the soft fork. For example, if I created a product on the blockchain, now I want to improve my own product, right, and I want to shift my community up, then it will be called a soft fork. A fork, right? And if it's a different blockchain altogether, then it will be called a hard fork.
Okay, so the hard fork would mainly be like the main source of it all, and then the soft port would be the connection to that hard port.
No. So these are two different things. For example, you want to fork my code or my software, right? How will you do it is for example, my software, my code will also exist on the blockchain, and your code will also exist in the market, right? Then it will be called a hard fork. But if I am forking myself and I don't want my previous version, it's like a soft fork is like a version 2 or version 3 or version 4 of the same product. But in the hard fork, you create a new product altogether using that code. So that's the difference.
Gotcha. Okay, I understand. I like that. That's pretty cool. So how are blocks linked in a blockchain?
So blocks are linked via something called it's like a chain, right? Where we use the hash from the last block as a starting point in the next fork. So it's like a chain, and they are connected, back to back in a serial order, and that's how we connect the forks. So for example, there will be a hash of every block, and that hash of every block will be as an input for the next block. That's how you know that okay, this block is a subsidiary of this, but it's a bit technical, and everybody need not to understand this thing.
Okay, gotcha. Okay, that's pretty cool. I like that. I like that. So one of the other things that I'm curious about is your book. You got the 44 Vedic Wealth Hacks. What does that entail?
So it's a very funny story. Me and my co-founder Deepak Goyal, we used to sit together a lot, and we used to discuss about entrepreneurs, right? Because as a budding entrepreneur, you also want to read the successful entrepreneurs in India and how they build their businesses and their startups and their enterprises. And but at the same time, you want to learn about the Vedas are like the ancient Indian text about our culture and everything. So we said that okay, we will discuss an entrepreneur every time we will sit together, and we'll write a chapter about it. So there are like 44 chapters that we wrote, every chapter about an entrepreneur. So every chapter is like a story of a different entrepreneur and how he used those Vedic learnings into while creating his enterprise.
Okay.
So that's the idea. So it's an async book, divided by emotions. For example, if you're feeling very optimistic today, so there will be a chapter called Optimism. You just go to the optimism chapter and there will be a lesson, a story of an entrepreneur that how he was optimistic and how optimism helps him. Or you are feeling pessimistic today, so you can go to a pessimist chapter and you can read about it and you learn. It's an async book. You can read any chapter at any point of time. Every chapter is like approximately a 5 to 6 minute read. Hence, it will not eat a lot of your time, and whatsoever feeling you have at that moment, you can read that chapter. So it's a unique book in that sense.
That's pretty cool. I like that. I like that. So how long did it take you to write this book?
So as I've already told you, me and my co-founder Deepak Goyal, we used to sit together and discuss about it, and we said, why not create a book out of it, or why not write a chapter about it? Okay, so yeah, so we had like 44 sittings, and in every sitting we used to write one chapter, and that's it.
Oh wow. Because in my book that I have on the market right now, my book is actually called Redeem Love, and it's a poetry
Okay.
book. And the poetry book is based actually for women to have something to read where they understand that there is a male out here who actually understands some of the things they go through, I
Wow.
meant to say. But on the flip side is to help the men understand how to put the love back into the relationship. So the messages in the poems are basically these things that's supposed to help males and females in one way or the other. And it literally took me 2 years to write that book because I wanted to convey a particular message to my audience. And I want to make sure that they understand what I was trying to say from their side as readers and not just from my side as an author.
Oh, that's really impressive, and I love poetry, and I'm a big poetry person, and I always read poetry, and it always, clears my soul in a sense, and hence I'll definitely give it a read.
Okay. Oh, that's pretty cool. I love it when, some people like poetry, some people say they don't like poetry, but a lot of people I've learned that say that they don't like poetry is because they don't understand it. It's not necessarily that they don't like it, they just don't understand.
So my mother was a literature teacher, right? So literature is a part of my culture, and I've read literature from like maybe 4 years of age.
Awesome.
Hence, I am very much into literature. It all kind of literature. It can be essays. It can be stories. It can be novels. It can be poetry, and everything I loved about it. Hence,
Yes.
I'm a big literature person. Yes, I was brought up in such a way.
Is awesome. So tell us, what are some of the teams and the clients from various industries that you've actually helped to manage?
So I, for example, in my apparel business, I as I've already told you, I worked with JP Morgan India. I worked with L'Oreal. I worked with Uber Eats. They are like some of the clients for my apparel business. And in this Web3 business, the blockchain business, I almost worked with everybody in the top 100. For example, the Near Protocol, it's very big. Internet Computer Protocol, ICP, I'm working as of now. I worked with Algorand, I worked with Aave, I worked with Polygon, I worked with WazirX. So
Some
there
pretty
these
big
are
names you're
the
naming there.
yeah
Those are some pretty big
yeah
names. I'm familiar with most of the names that you said. They're some pretty big names. And I've done Uber Eats as a driver before, but I didn't know
oh.
that they were even dealing with anything outside of that because I never did the research on a company like that. But that's pretty impressive. You're dealing with some pretty big names out here. Wow. So it in your profile, you stated that as a blockchain maximalist who believes in endorses the power of decentralization and community-driven initiatives in every sphere of life. So tell us more about that so that people can understand what you mean by that.
So decentralization is very important. For example, the most decentralized resource that we have is sunlight. If you have sunlight, right, you can put up solar panels on your roof anywhere in the world. You might be living in a desert or you might be living in a mountain. If you have access to sunlight, you put up a solar panel and voila, you have access to electricity, right? It's the most decentralized asset, nobody can control it. So in a similar way, in our technology, the problem was that everything is very centralized. For example, if you are releasing this podcast on YouTube and YouTube tomorrow thinks that you are a threat to them, then they can put you down, right? They can take off your channel without your permission, even if it has million followers. We have seen these stories like happening in the past, which will be up then in reality, do you own this channel? Because again, if you own this channel, then how is somebody else can put this down, right? Hence, this is a centralized challenge that we have in our market. For example, all of our social media is controlled by Meta or Snapchat and all of these players, and all our hardware is controlled by Apple and Samsung and all of these players, and it possesses a threat to us. Hence, we need decentralized technology because internet is very centralized today. We need a decentralized format that is not controlled by any one party. Yet, right? If you want to control a piece of it, you can contribute to the ecosystem by running nodes or via mining Bitcoin. You should have power, but can you do the same for internet? You can't do it, right? Because again, as I've told you about node also, that you can download the whole ledger and you can verify every transaction from the first transaction to the very recent transaction on your computer. Can you do this with the internet? You can't. So this is the problem. With the centralized structures, that they are bound to fail, and they have a central or single point of failure that is the central authority who owns that platform. So we want to eliminate that single point of failure, and we want to give back ownership to the people in each and every aspect. So that's the purpose of decentralization.
Okay, that's pretty
Yeah.
cool.
And community building on the other part is very different. For example, everything was run by communities before the Walmart and everything came into the picture, right? We want to bring that culture back where communities run everything. So
That is awesome.
from yeah, so that's all about the Web3 industry in a nutshell.
That is awesome. I like that. I like that. That reminds me of kind of like how it was in one of the neighborhoods that I lived in, because I'm originally from Chicago. And in Chicago, the area that we lived in, a lot of the elders would invest back into our neighborhood. They would endorse certain things that some of the students were doing. Like, for example, we were very heavy into breakdancing. I know breakdance is a pretty old dance, but there are some things in hip hop where they're actually still doing some forms of breakdancing. And a lot of the elders would put money into that so that we could just do things that would keep us from getting in trouble as children, because children are going to get in trouble. That's just life. You can't do anything about that. But what you can do is help to deter that by giving them some forms of recreation that would actually help them to stay away from being in trouble, because they most of the time are getting in trouble because they don't have anything to do.
Absolutely. So it's a similar story here as well. So yeah. So you really summed that up really well.
So, and I love the fact that you're a self-motivated professional. That self-motivated people, in my opinion, because I'm also a self-motivated person, but self-motivated people, in my opinion, are some of the most dedicated people ever, because it doesn't take for you to listen to somebody else or to see someone else doing something for you to actually act on a situation that you see deems that your attention. You know what I'm saying? So that is wonderful. So how has the industry grown that since you started? What has been basically some percentages or some numbers that some of our people can understand to show its growth.
So the industry has grown, quite aggressively and in the positive way. For example, when I started in the Web3 industry, it was very difficult to create a wallet and to very difficult to buy a wallet, buy Bitcoin, because no exchanges were there. You have to, do some ex the transfer or exchange of Bitcoin via some shady marketplaces, and you have to talk to some brokers to exchange the Bitcoin. Now it's all exchanges and it works like charm. It's very easy. If you want to buy some Bitcoin, you can buy it like from the PayPal in a minute, right? It's very easy. It's very convenient. Now you can set up your wallets on your mobile devices or on your computer. Earlier it was very difficult to do so. Hence, the use of Bitcoin and the experience of owning a Bitcoin is very enhanced, and it's very user friendly now. With ETFs, they have taken it one step further, that now you can invest in Bitcoin with the regulated players in the regulated market. Hence, you don't have to worry about anything, security and everything, because everything will be taken care of by the stakeholders, which is a great thing. The ecosystem and the builders are growing, and they are building different products for the market so that people can enter and can explore the ecosystem. Hence, the market is growing, and the ease of use for the regular people are is something that really excites me from 2016 to 2024.
Wow, that is awesome. That's what's up. So, being in the industry, how has the industry helped to mold you personally? Like, what were you like when you first started, and how are you now? How have you changed now from the time that you started?
So this industry humbled me, first of all, a bit, and on a philosophical level, I believe that I am a more evolved person. There's a lot of room to grow yet. I don't deny that. But again, I'm an evolved person. It gives a maturity to me. I am now I understand a lot of new subjects such as interest rates, finance, economics, the macroeconomics, and how our monetary system. Because in this industry, if you dig deep, then you will understand all these concepts. So this industry taught me a lot. I'm still learning, and it humbled me to my core, because I've seen like every kind of rituals. I've seen every kind of philosophers. I've seen people with the great capabilities, coding capabilities, great skill that is unmatchable. And yet they are so humble, yet they are so welcoming, yet they are so welcome, they are so helpful. Hence, I've learned the humbleness from this industry. So this is the one major thing that was changed in me because of the Web3 industry. And the other thing is, I've learned a lot of it, and I'm still learning.
Awesome. And to say that you're still learning also shows that the company is still growing. For those of you who are not really into paying attention to how things are worded or how things are said to you, if you listen in, he say he's still learning. Mr. Bansal say he's still learning. That means that the company is also still growing. There's a lot more growth potential in the company.
Yeah, absolutely. So my company is also growing, and the industry as a whole is also growing. So you have to learn, and you have to be on your toes. Even when I sleep, at the next morning after 8 hours of sleep, when I wake up, I think that I've missed out on something. In the last 8 hours, so much has happened, right? And I need to catch up now. So again, yes. You always learn.
Yes, indeed. It's like a love hate for that type of feeling, though. It's like you love the fact that everything is constantly growing, but you kind of hate the fact to feel like you're missing out on something.
Absolutely, yo. So there's a catch-up game, right? Because the industry is growing so fast that you have to catch up. Every of one. Then and now, which gives you that energy, or that gives you that butterfly in your stomach. That okay, I need to catch up. That kind of thing.
Yes,
Yeah,
indeed.
sure.
So tell us, what has been one of the worst times that you've had during your business, whether it been the business, whether it been personal, and how did you overcome that? Because some of our people need to hear your story so they can understand if they ever fall into that situation, how to overcome the situation.
So there are like few times that I want to recall. For example, I was the biggest Web3 influencer on TikTok globally, and I used to teach people about finance on TikTok. And I was, we started the EduTalk program in India, where we used to create educational videos on TikTok for this purpose. And I was growing very fast on TikTok, and India decided to ban TikTok as a platform, and I lost everything, every follower that I had, every thing that I had. And you can still, if you have TikTok, you can check my channel. It's called finstrade.in, and I lost it all in a day, and it was a shocking thing for me at that point of time that I lost that platform. But again, at the same time, I was very low. But then I bounced back. I talked to other platform and I created content on another platform, and we bounced back. The other time was when India decided to ban to put a banking ban on cryptocurrencies, trading of cryptocurrencies, which was again a very shocking moment for me at that point of time as well. So these two moments are the lowest moments in my financial and personal life. And I was very low on confidence, and I lost everything in a fraction of a second. And it was, I went into depression post that, because again, you feel it once it happens to you. Yeah.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Well, I'm so happy that you were able to bounce back. How long did it take you from the time that you were down before you actually were able to bounce back? What was the time span in that?
So the first week is very poor, was very bad, as I can recall. I was just lying on my bed and I was clueless. And I lost it all, and I created it in a year, and in my years of hard work, went into vain, with one decision, and how do I come back from this? But again, after 1 week, I put myself again, and I wanted, as a warrior, as an entrepreneur, you have to go into the field, you have to go into the war, and you have to start grinding again, right? Because that's the way you live, that's the way life is. So yeah. So it took a week. The first week was very bad, and then slowly and steadily I bounced back.
Awesome. So if someone else were to ever go down like that, what would you tell them to kind of give them that spark again? How would you give them that spark?
I would say that if you are time rich, right? For example, if I tell you that I'll give you $1 billion, would you take it? You will happily take it. But if there's a trade-off that you get the $1 billion and you'll be 100 years old, will you still take it? You won't, because you will think that what I will do with $1 billion if I'm 100 years old, right? Because I'll die in a year or two. We all are time rich. We all have time in our lifetime, right? If you are in your 20s, 30s, or maybe in 40s also, then also there's a time to bounce back. So if you are time rich, then you have the most valuable currency in the world, which is time. And so think it from this perspective, and this might be able to help you. Whenever I'm down, I think from this perspective that okay, I'm 28 years old today, right? And I think that okay, I have another maybe 32 years of my work life left with me. Hence, I have 32 years of my work life and probably 50 years of my lifespan that is with me still. If even if we take the average lifespan of a person, then I'm very fortunate that I'm time rich and I have a lot of time to accomplish things, and whatsoever I've lost, it can be love, it can be relationships, it can be money, it can be your business, it can be your any other asset, you can always regain that in the time that you have. So
Yes,
always take it
indeed. Yes,
on good side.
indeed. Words to live by. So, are you based out of India now?
Yeah, I'm born and brought up in India only.
Okay. That's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. Have you traveled to other countries, other cities, other states?
Yeah, so I've traveled to Dubai a couple of times, even, and I go to Dubai like every once in every 3 months for some business purposes. And then I've traveled to Europe, I've traveled to North America, not exactly US, but Canada, and yeah.
Okay,
But
cool. So do you take any time to yourself? What is your leisure time like?
so I really like reading. So reading is one of my personal me times that I have. I love listening to music, or maybe to go in orchestra and hear some live music is something which is my thing. And so reading and listening to music is something that I enjoy.
Awesome. So, what's one of your favorite songs?
So they are mostly Indian songs, so you would
Well,
know.
believe it or not, where I am right now here in Texas, there's a lot of Indians here. There's a lot of different cultures here where I am, and I actually interact with a bunch of people.
So we are the most populous country in the world. Wherever you go, you'll find Indians everywhere.
That's pretty cool. I like that. I love it. I love it. So, what are some of your proven P&L ownership and leadership skills that you teach other people?
I don't teach leadership, right? Because I think leadership is something that comes from within. If you are ready to take a bullet for your team, for your people, then you are a good leader. If you're afraid to do so, then it's fine. There's nothing wrong with it. But then you're not a leader. So if you're a leader, then you have to have all the hard wound and all the bad words for your side, and all the good things will be distributed among your team. So yeah, so that's the definition of leadership for me.
I totally agree with you on that. I totally agree with that. And so, can you elaborate a little bit more? You said a extensive experience in starting things from scratch across the industries, such as blockchain, apparel, FMCG, customer service. So, what do you mean by starting things from scratch? I mean, I know what it means, but we have some young listeners who don't really understand. So, that's why I'm asking you to explain.
So whenever I started a business, right, for example, in my apparel business, we had no background, we had no money, and I created that startup from brick by brick, and it was completely bootstrap startup, right? And so we did everything by our own, which particularly means starting from the scratch, that is starting from the rock bottom without any knowledge about the industry, without any prior experience or prior network or prior connections in the industry. And learning everything on our own, which is particularly our USP as well, as a company, and we learned everything on our own. So that's why we started everything from scratch. Yeah. So starting from scratch means, for the listeners, starting from the scratch means starting from the ground up and without any base, in the industry.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Starting from scratch can be hard. It just depends on the industry. It depends on the type of business that you're doing. It depends on how you get your business out there, so to speak, to where people can become familiar, or people can start to recognize the type of business that you're doing. So if you don't do anything to get your business out there, then how about you just sit on that idea until you're actually ready to act on the idea? Because if you don't act on it, it's a waste of time.
Absolutely, 100%, right? If you miss the 100% of the chances that you don't take, right?
Yes, indeed. Hey,
So
who
yeah.
wants to start out like that? I don't think anybody want to ever have to go through that ever, because that
Yeah.
can be real hard. It can be real challenging. So
Yeah.
you help to empower people so that they can actually do better in the type of business that you're doing with blockchain. What are some of the advices that you would give people so that they can invest in blockchain, so they can actually get started and they can actually do better once they're in there?
The first advice is don't listen to advisors, because there are like a lot of people who are giving advices in the blockchain sector. A lot of people are scammers. So it's very important to mute all that advices that you will hear on the internet, on the Twitter, now X or Instagram or YouTube. What you have to do is think of your own. Start with Bitcoin. Don't go haywire. And it's very important to learn all of these things.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. So is are there any like books or websites or sources of information where you would suggest people to start from?
Yeah, so I mentioned in the podcast as well. So the biggest book that you can, the best book that you can learn as a beginner is the Bitcoin Standard. It's a great read, and once you go through it, you will understand the philosophies why Bitcoin was created and why Bitcoin is important. If you are a builder and you want to build in the Web3 space, you want to learn about the coding and the algorithms that run the Web3 space, then Mastering Bitcoin is another great book. So the Bitcoin Standard for the non-technical people and the Mastering Bitcoin for the technical people.
So what are some of the basics that people should have before they start to invest into the Bitcoin business?
So basics you have to learn about it, how to set up a wallet, how to set up how you know how to set up an account on an exchange from where you can withdraw your bitcoins. So yeah, so that's pretty much it, right?
Okay. So now I know you talked about this before, but the way that you explained it in such detail. So the way that I'm going to ask you this is basically simplifying it. So now people that invest into Bitcoin now, when they look at the platforms, they're more user friendly now versus how they were in the past. Am I correct?
100%.
Yes. Yes, indeed. Because that's what I was, that's one of the things that a lot of people who still aren't using computers that much or not as computer savvy, they're still afraid to even take the to make the attempt to do anything on the computer because they're still afraid from the past.
For example, if you're sitting in the US, then you just have to download the Coinbase application, for example. It's a mobile application just like WhatsApp and Facebook and Instagram. You download it on your iPhone and then you create an account and then voila, you are good to go. And then you can invest your money in Bitcoin via that platform. It's very easy to use these days and they are very secure platforms. Hence, you can trust them to some extent.
Yes, indeed. That's one thing I've learned because I have my own blockchain wallet. And one thing I've learned is it is real easy to set up. It's real simple. The tricky part sometimes, one of the things that I ran into when I first got started was just knowing how much to invest or how much I
Right.
could versus how much I couldn't invest. Those were the trickier parts.
Yeah, the financial discipline is very important once you're investing in all these asset classes because these are new and riskier asset classes. So your asset allocation and the discipline should be there when you are interacting with all of these assets.
And for me, that was about maybe seven years ago when I first got started doing that. So it was a bit challenging to me then. And I look at how it was just 7 years ago versus how it is now. And it's so much easier to see what you're doing, see how to go about doing it. And they also provide you a lot of links and information, you know. So that's another good thing too. For people who don't really know how to do it, that's another good thing. That once you get in there, they provide you a link and say, "Hey, here's the details on how to do this or how to do that," and they literally walk you through it. So for people who don't like to call customer service because they don't feel comfortable with the customer service, there's a link. Click on the link, and the link will walk you through it. Just like people who do IT work, they have a page that walks you through every step on how to do things. So that's a blessing.
Absolutely, absolutely. These days you'll get a lot of things and you do a lot of learning and the information is available to each and everybody, which is a good thing, which is a great thing.
Yes, indeed. And there's so much of it out here. So do you only do your platforms based out of India, or do you also do platforms in other countries?
We use Indian platforms as well as the global platform for various purposes. So we are not confined geographically, right? And We work with Binance also. We work with KuCoin also, various other platforms. So yeah, we work with all the global players.
That is awesome. That is awesome. I love it, man. Alrighty. So, oh man, this has been powerful. We're getting so close to our time. Do me a favor and let our people know something motivational.
Yeah, I'm not a guy who gives the motivational things out, but I'll just say if you are just give it a try, right? There's no harm in trying. Read few articles, read few follow some good few influencers who are working in this space, and you'll learn a lot of new things, even if you don't make money, if you don't want to invest money, but you'll learn a lot of things. So it this sector is give or in general, in life, if you know about something, give it a try once, right? It might hit, it might not hit, but you don't have regrets, right? Don't live with regrets.
Yes,
So yeah,
indeed.
that's something that I want to
Hey, that was powerful, whether you believe in it or not. That was
do.
powerful.
I don't think so. I don't agree with you.
Hey, I tell you'll be surprised at just the smallest words that we use, how those words have such a huge impact on other people. So believe you me, that was powerful. Somebody will hear that. Somebody needed to hear that.
I hope so.
So let us know how we can actually reach you.
So you can reach me out on Twitter X, which is by my name called Bandhul Bansal, or you can join our community on Telegram, which is twosphere.in.
Awesome. Also, one other thing before you go, I'm wanting our people to see. I'm going to share my screen with you right quick. I want our people to see your website. Because I love the how you had I am Bandhul Bansal, and you have the different titles and things that's showing things that you actually do. That's actually pretty cool.
Thanks a lot. And do you get my all the contact information here as well, once you scroll down?
All the companies and stuff that you work with,
That no,
and
that these are the companies that I've invested in. So
okay.
I'm invested in all these companies, yeah.
Okay, so these are the companies that you're industry in, all these companies. So this is a
No.
wonderful
Yeah,
platform.
so I invest I'm invested in all of these companies, yeah.
Awesome. This is really cool. So 12 plus projects funded, 50 plus colleges visited in 8 years. And the email
Right.
address here, everybody, for how to reach Mr. Bonso. So that's pretty cool there. I really like this. You got your website, it's informative and it's simple. And you can also read about Mr. Bonsu on his website. So this is pretty cool. This is pretty cool.
Thank you. I'm really thankful for this warm or kind gesture.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Is warranted. All the things that you've done, all the communities that you've helped out in, how you invest in different companies, different platforms. This is something that the world needs to know that is happening. That way they don't feel like, that there's nobody trying to do anything to help society, because this actually helps society. It helps society as a whole. It helps people to have a place where they can actually invest their money and make more money, even if it is in cryptocurrency. And a lot of people don't understand cryptocurrency, but you're offering an opportunity to help them understand it better. It's awesome.
Thank you, for hosting me.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much for joining YTP Entertainment. I am looking forward to posting this video, and I will definitely be sending a copy to you. Thank you so much. Many blessings. I look forward to
Bye.
your future and getting to know more about what's going on with your platform. Peace and blessings.
Absolutely,
So.
we'll get in touch. Bye bye.
Have a great day. Bye bye.
Bye.